Belinda and Gil Books present this unabridged recording of Noni and the Great Chawwwklit Mystery, written and read by Dermot Whelan. Dedication. For Dermot Sr., I know you'd get a great kick out of this, and for the wonderful people of Limerick. Meet the characters. Noni, Limerick's most notorious, celebrated chocolate seller. Never afraid to cut a few pesky corners to make a profit, even if that means potentially poisoning her customers with her crazy concoctions. Chunks McSturdy's number one fan. Francis, loyal servant to Noni and world's worst guard bird. Loves a good audiobook. Sean, age 10, big brain, small clothes. Quick with a fact and great with numbers. Loves Noni and making fake sweets. Emma, age 12, hates being bored and loves an adventure. Wishes she had more independence and wishes Noni would follow stricter health and safety guidelines. Chunks McSturdy, Munster's finest ever rugby player. Dashing good looks and incredible sporting ability. A chin you could grate cheese on and grate with a machine gun. Marguerite, posh pram merchant. Loves anything pink. Also Chunks McSturdy's number one fan. Noni's arch enemy. Appreciates a good quality welly boot. Nolene, a no-nonsense bagpipe-playing recluse who knows her way around a herb garden and a book of spells. Very angry with Noni over something rather disgusting. Tom, excellent at making inventions, terrible at naming them. Always ready to lend a hand and loves a good bowl of beans. Prologue. There isn't much light in the cave, but one crisp shaft of sunlight entering through a crack in the rock is enough to illuminate the murky, bubbling mess in the centre of the cave floor. Steam rises to the roof of the cavern as the brown, tar-like substance begins to froth angrily and spit out over the edges of the pool. A wicked stench fills the air. Darkness falls, engulfing whatever light was struggling to survive in this terrible place. It's going to need more than a good plumber to sort this one out. Chapter 1. "Where are those little pups?" mumbled the old woman as she bashed her buckety pram off her sitting room furniture. She was attempting to navigate an unholy mess of boxes and packaging that were strewn across the floor of her tiny terraced house. Her home, nestled in the shadow of Limerick's Thomond Park Stadium, consisted of one small bedroom, a very messy sitting room, and a wardrobe pretending it was a kitchen. No ordinary person would attempt to run a business from such a confined space. This, however, was no ordinary old woman, and no ordinary pram. This was Noni Considine, the greatest and most controversial pram-based chocolate seller in all of Limerick City. And she was in a hurry. Today was the day of the big match, and big match days were when she made her best money. She'd be outside that rugby stadium selling sweets, chocolate and fizzy drinks to anyone with a tooth in their head. That would have ruled out half the city when Noni was growing up, but not now. Dentists were much better these days and used far fewer gardening tools to do their job. So her business was booming. Well, it would have been if her two supposed helpers hadn't been running late again.
"How am I supposed to get all this ready for the suckers, customers, if I have to do everything by myself?"
Noni ripped the top off a bag and poured what looked like frozen peas out onto the coffee table. Francis, her pet raven, was perched in his usual spot on the handle of her pram. He had his mind on more important matters and was wearing headphones, being partial to a self-help podcast or two. Francis, although a raven, fancied himself as a kind of feathery guard dog. In the cut-and-thrust world of pram-based street vending, security is always advised, and Francis was prepared to challenge anyone brave or foolish enough to try to take on Noni. Sure, he was small in stature, but in a tricky situation, he could be quite formidable. He had a beak, and he knew how to use it. Unfortunately, he was often so engrossed in his audiobooks and podcasts, he missed most of the action when it went down. Noni had lost count of the number of times an opportunistic hand had reached into the pram and her guard bird had been mentally somewhere else. Suddenly, there was a knock at the door and a young boy's voice called through the letterbox.
Noni, it's us. We're here.
About time, huffed Noni, continuing to mumble under her breath as she made her way to the door.
It was impossible to make out exactly what she was saying, but it seemed to include the words Perpetual Sacred Heart, some saints' names, and she may have sworn a few times. Although the journey to the door was only a few feet, it took her forever to get there, with all the clutter in the way.
Noni, we're here, said the letterbox again.
I'm coming, you little...
Before she could reach it, the front door burst open, and two children fell through it, landing on the doormat in a messy heap. Emma and her younger brother Seán looked up at Noni with matching broad grins.
What in God's name are ye up to? Noni cried. That's the most dramatic entrance I've seen since Father O'Riordan fell off the choir balcony last Christmas.
Hi, Noni,
came a voice from outside. The children's mum hovered anxiously on the pavement while their dad waited impatiently in the car.
Are you sure you're still okay to mind them for the night? I'm sorry it's so last minute, but we need to get new stock for the shop, and it'll be so much easier on our own.
They owned an antique store in the centre of town and often had to go to trade shows and markets all over the world. Noni was their nearest neighbour and was used to helping out.
No problem. Off you go. See you then. Bye-bye, said Noni, flustered, as she did her best to get rid of them.
We're still interested in buying that pram of yours, you know, Noni. It's a fabulous antique and worth a few bob, I dare say.
Emma and Seán's father called out from the car hopefully.
I'm afraid not, said Noni through gritted teeth, doing her best to be polite. It's still not for sale.
Pity. Anyway, we'll be back tomorrow night to pick them up.
Okay, no problem. Bye-bye. See you then. Safe antiquing.
Noni was keen to get cracking on her preparations for the match day sales.
Aunt Noni, called the kid's dad. No crazy stuff this time, yeah?
Of course not. I'll wrap them in cotton wool as always. Bye-bye.
She waved them off at last and turned to go inside.
Antique! How dare they! That pram is state-of-the-art. Sure, it's only 52 years old.
She slammed the door shut, but it swung open again straight away.
You really have to get that front door latch fixed, Noni, said Emma, as she picked her and Seán's overnight bag up off the floor. It's been weeks since that angry customer kicked it down, and it's not safe.
I would ask the locksmith to fix it, said Noni, but the man who kicked it down is the locksmith. And I don't know what his problem was anyway. Those Easter eggs I gave him were perfect. I thought the broken glass gave them a bit of extra crunch.
Seán laughed and looked around the room with excitement. He thought Noni was hilarious and big match days were his favourite. The excited buzz of the crowds, the yelling and selling, and most of all, the feast of leftover sweets and chocolate at the end of it. He spied the raven on the pram and gave him a wave.
Hiya, Francis, he said.
The bird nodded briefly, then went back to listening intently to his audiobook. Seán's blonde hair was straight and short. He was small for his age, and sometimes that annoyed him. He found he didn't get picked for sports teams much, and his mother always had to buy him clothes for kids way younger than his actual age. Most of the other kids at school wore tracksuits and sports clothes and cool trainers, but he preferred smart trousers and shirts. He felt they made him look a bit more grown up, and he kind of felt like his dad in them. He loved science and had tons of books on space, rockets, bridges, nature, you name it. And if you suddenly needed to know the surface temperature of Jupiter's moon, then he was your man. It's minus 260 degrees Fahrenheit, by the way. He saw it in a documentary. He was also pretty good at maths, keeping track of all Noni's pram transactions on an app on his phone. He loved hanging out with Noni. She was always good fun and she never teased him, unlike his sister. Emma wasn't as keen as her brother on being babysat by Noni, or anyone else for that matter. She was only 12, but she liked to think she was much more mature than other kids. Definitely mature enough to be allowed to stay home by herself anyway. Emma was an adventurer.
She had climbed every tree within a mile of her home and loved to watch survival shows on TV. Her tracksuit bottoms were always covered in grass stains, but her skateboard tricks were coming along nicely, and she'd even built a ramp for her rollerblades. She'd been planning to spend the day trying it out until her parents had sprung this latest buying trip on her. Selling chocolate from a pram at Noni didn't seem that exciting in comparison. She sighed and tucked a strand of her long, wavy brown hair behind her ear as she looked around. The floor and furniture of Noni's sitting room were covered with Noni's merchandise. There was everything you'd expect Limerick's finest pram confectionery merchant to have in stock, from chocolate bars to fizzy drinks, but there were some stranger items there too. Tins of vegetables, women's makeup kits, and lots of paint. It was probably a good thing that the carpet and furniture were covered in all of this because they, like Noni, had seen better days. One time, Seán had stared too long at the swirly pattern on the carpet and it had made him so dizzy he'd thrown up on Noni's couch, though in actual fact, that had only improved it.
"Hurry up," said Noni. "You two are late and this pram won't fill itself."
"Mam and Dad said you have to let us go to bed before midnight. They're worried you're a bad influence," said Emma, slightly distracted by the messiness of the room.
"A bad influence? How dare they? Didn't I teach you how to swim?"
"By pushing us off a bridge," replied Emma, frowning and folding her arms.
"And didn't I bring you to the zoo last week?"
asked Noni. Seán chuckled. "That was three donkeys in a field, Noni, and you made us ride them to the supermarket."
"Well, I can't carry everything. That was my big weekly shop. Anyway, don't I pay you for your work?"
"No," the children said in unison.
"Well, if your parents are that worried, why do they keep asking me to babysit you?"
"'Cause you're cheap," said Seán.
"And don't forget available," said Noni. "The most important quality in a childminder. Now, unless you prefer to be doing homework, hop to it."
And she waved a bony finger at them. There was no doubt Noni was a strange-looking woman. You wouldn't necessarily say that she was ugly, because that would be unkind. But when in her company, you weren't sure whether to stare or look away. Though her skin was rosy and youthful, Noni had grey facial hair. Emma had given her a voucher for a beauty parlour one birthday to have it removed. Noni, however, thought it made her look distinguished and had swapped the voucher for custard. She also had a rather crooked nose, but that was balanced out by her crooked chin. Her eyes, however, were beautiful. They were deep blue and always sparkled, projecting kindness, mischief, and excitement all rolled into one. Even when she was cross with the children, Noni's eyes seemed to say otherwise. If she was angry with anyone other than Emma and Seán, however, say if someone tried to touch her pram without permission, she had a fierce look that would melt rocks. But when she smiled, it made you want to smile too. On the end of her nose sat a pair of thin gold-rimmed glasses that she rarely ever actually looked through. She always wore the same faded purple coat and brown headscarf, whether it was the depths of winter or a scorching summer's day. The children had never seen her in anything else, and whenever they tried to imagine her as a baby, they pictured her lying in her pram in the same coat and scarf. She seemed to have endless amounts of energy, and despite having a slight stoop, she could really motor when she wanted to. Noni had been part of the children's lives for as long as they could remember. In fact, she had been part of the family since before they were even born. Living at the end of their street, Noni had even minded their father David when he was young. Seán and Emma's dad often spoke about all the dinners Noni had made him when he lost his mother as a teenager. And Seán and Emma's own mother, Siobhan, often mentioned how Noni had been one of the first to welcome her to the neighbourhood when she moved there after her marriage. Despite Noni's eccentric ways, they all had a soft spot for her and knew that she enjoyed the children's company, even if she didn't always admit it. If you asked Noni, she'd probably tell you she needed them for one purpose and one purpose only, to sell chocolate. Noni's sales system was pretty much the same for every match. Fill the bottom rack of the pram with the heavy stuff, fizzy drink cans, boxes of bars, and Noni's change stick. When Noni produced the big wooden stick, people rarely stuck around for their change. Then the pram itself got filled with the loose stuff, crisps, chocolate bars, packets of sweets, and jellies. It was an ancient pram, like you'd see in old black and white photos of babies at the seaside. It had definitely been through the wars and been patched up again on many occasions. It was basically held together with twine, old chewing gum, and hope. But those old prams were big and could hold a lot, which meant less running back and forth for Seán and Emma to restock. As well as the two main pram compartments, there was another, smaller one, which was situated under the hood. This was for special sweets, and preparing these special sweets was the children's most important job.
"Get working on those peas," said Noni. "The nail varnish is over there in that box."
You see, Noni liked to cut a few corners when it came to her business, and anywhere she could make a quick buck, she would. She thought confectionery in general was too expensive, and how was she to make a decent profit if the sweets were too dear to buy in the first place? So Seán and Emma were tasked with creating alternative versions of popular treats, which would then be sold to unsuspecting customers as the real thing. Hence the Frozen Pea Project. The peas were painted with different coloured nail varnish to look like Skittles. Chickpeas were dipped in cold gravy to pass for Maltesers, and chew bars were reimagined by picking lumps of chewing gum off the road, sticking them together, then rolling them flat with a rolling pin and putting them in the fridge to harden. As a budding scientist, Seán loved these crazy food inventions and saw the whole thing as one big science experiment. Now his tongue was poking from the corner of his mouth as he sat at the table and concentrated on painting a very tiny pea. Emma was not so convinced, and probably with some justification, was more concerned with the health implications of eating these creations. Noni was a hard taskmaster, though, so Emma continued dipping the chickpeas in gravy. As well as the homemade versions, there were also some other treats that, at first glance, looked like the real deal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.